Amen, amen.
Amen.
Our scripture for today will be taken from Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 through 13. Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 through 13. I want to thank our inspirational choir for being faithful to go through the hymnal and share with us some of the songs that have given us strength throughout the years. That song in particular they just sang, I remember as a child hearing that one growing up and just seemed like somehow new words. But sometimes in my darkest moments, the songs like that that I remember are the ones that I sing to myself. Sometimes you have to encourage yourself in the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Exodus 17, verses 8 through 13. Amen?
Amen?
Will you now rest on your feet for the reading of God's Word? From the New King James Version of the Bible, the Word of God reads, Now Amalek came and fought with Israel and Rephidim, and Moses said to Joshua, Choose us some men and go out and fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses said to him and fought with Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And so it was when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands became heavy, so they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it, and Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. Let us pray. Father, thank you for the reading, hearing, and understanding of your word. And we pray, Father, that today you would begin to give us some encouragement to walk in our destiny. God, I ask very humbly that you would allow your spirit to work through me for your glory, that this body of Christ would be edified, and you, Holy Father, would be glorified. Change us, Lord, from the inside out. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated in the presence of God. And we thank the ushers this morning for your service. And today, we're going to begin a series called Walk Into Your Destiny. We're going to spend 4 weeks together looking at the development of Joshua. So who is this Joshua? We don't get a lot of information about him early on. We just hear his name in this one particular passage that Moses has called upon him. But based on the circumstances, we must assume a few things. This is during the time when the children of Israel have crossed the Red Sea. They have been slaves in Egypt for about 400 years. Moses comes along. God leads them out. Pharaoh's army is drowned in the sea, and now they're out in the wilderness. And during this time, they come across another king, a king named Amalek and his people. And Moses turns to Joshua and says, hey, get us an army together. Now think about this. Joshua just came out of slavery. Joshua was born in slavery. In fact, all of these people that are with Moses, all of them were born slaves. And now they are free for the first time. And this group of slaves has a young man named Joshua who's been charged with gathering the slaves together, who only knew how really to make bricks and build the temples and things they wanted in Egypt and building pyramids. These slaves are now charged with going out to fight against a king and his trained army.
Yes.
And Moses just calls Joshua. We don't know why he called on Joshua. But here's something that we know. When we get further along in the scriptures, you go all the way through to the book of Joshua, you find out that this Joshua went from being a slave to being a ruler of more than a million people. And not only a ruler, but a great military general who goes into the promised land with this group of folks.
Yeah.
After raising up a whole other generation, after the older generation died, and he conquers the promised land.
Yeah.
So what are the qualities? What are the qualities that takes a person from rock bottom to being the one that's on the top? What are the qualities that take you from being average to being extraordinary? We're going to explore that for the next few weeks because I believe those same qualities can be applied to our lives today. So today, even though this series is entitled Walk Into Your Destiny, today I just want to give you a message entitled Prove Yourself. Prove Yourself. And the first thing I want to tell you about proving yourself is that you've got to join the battle. So looking back at the scripture, it says, now Amalek came and fought with Israel and Rephidim, and Moses said to Joshua, choose us some men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. And he says, so Joshua did as Moses said to him and followed Amalek, and Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. So we have this circumstance where Joshua is told to go and get together an army. He looks out among all of the children of Israel, and he's searching for folks, and he gathers together this mighty army to go out and fight against this Amalek. Now, remember now, Joshua is he's now a free slave. We don't know what his fighting habits are. We don't know what his leadership qualities are. But obviously, Moses saw some potential in him. And Moses has called his name. What happens when someone calls your name? And they give you the opportunity to stand and do something that you haven't done before. Joshua does not flinch. Joshua does not make excuses. Joshua goes out and he finds an army. So, I believe that that's one of the things we've got to do is we actually have to get in the battle because you can't move to the next place that God wants you to go if you don't take the first step.
Right.
Especially when God gives you the opportunity. Well, there it is, y'all. There it is. 1978 Pontiac Trans Am. 6.6 liter engine. And that one just happened to have a little extra something in there. This was my father's car. And when I turned 15, my father decided you've got to learn how to drive. And he decided I was learning how to drive on that monster right there.
Yeah.
Now, let me tell you something. When he started the engine, it would rattle the windows of the neighbor's house.
Yeah.
You know, it was one of these big, deep, you know, it was like that. And the car was so powerful, he would get it up to on the interstate to 70 miles per hour, and this is what it would sound like. Just a nice hum, like it was just taking a jog at 70. He says, you're going to learn how to drive. Now, I'm thinking to myself, Lord have mercy on the rest of the driving community. Because he decides to do this while I'm spending time with him during the summer, and it's the middle of the day, and there's traffic.
Yeah.
And my father decides to put me behind the wheel of that car. I will tell you right now, the only thing I knew how to do was keep my foot on the brake.
Yeah.
He told me, he said, just put it in reverse and ease off the brake. I put it in reverse and eased off the brake, and the car started moving. I got out and I got into the middle of the road. He says, now put it in drive. Now just ease off the brake. He didn't say anything about pressing gas. Which is good because when I took my foot completely off the brake, after about two blocks, the car was already up to 35 miles per hour. And he's teaching me how to drive. My heart is pounding. I'm nervous. There are other cars on the street. I'm thinking, Lord, don't let me hit them. And eventually we did get to the point where I was allowed to press the accelerator, but here's something I realized. If I did not, because of the circumstance, I was visiting him for the summer. I usually spend like 2 weeks at a time with him during the summer. If I did not get into the car then and do as he had instructed me to do, I would have had to wait another year until I was 16 to learn how to drive. Joshua had his opportunity put in front of him.
Yeah.
Joshua was given the charge. He didn't say, well, Moses, you know what? Maybe this leader of my tribe, because I'm from the tribe of Ephraim, maybe this other guy over here will do a better job.
Yeah.
Maybe he could get him. No, he didn't shirk the responsibility. He didn't sit on the sideline. He made sure that when his moment came, he stepped forward to prove himself. He joined the battle. When the opportunity presents itself in your life, do not wait. I've heard people say opportunity doesn't knock twice. Sometimes it doesn't knock. And you just got to know that God is about to do something in your life, and you just need to be able to step. So I'm telling you, there have been some times in my life that opportunity did not lock and did not knock, because opportunity had the key. And all opportunity had to do was open the door. So I had to go through the door. There was no time to wait. The same must be true for us as well. Because the truth is, we can't sit around and we can't make excuses. Don't be surprised if the road to your destiny is full of obstacles. There's always a fight for what's important. There's always going to be a struggle. Even for the children of Israel to eventually take the promised land, they literally had to still go fight. Even though it was promised to them, they had to seize it. Which means for us, we must seize things as well. We can't be like the guy who plays basketball. I know there's basketball championships going on. You know, and I played basketball when I was in middle school, and we used to have this joke, you know, certain people on the team never got into the game. They played three positions. They played center, guard, and forward. They sat in the center of the bench. They guarded the Gatorade and looked forward to the next game. Can't be that way when it comes to your destiny. You've got to get in the game.
Yeah, right.
You've got to go in and contribute whatever little amount you can, because this is a battle that's going on for you. For some of you, you're in a battle for your family.
Amen.
You're battling for them, and you can't just bail out. You can't just decide, well, you know, I don't feel like being a dad today. I don't feel like being a mom today. I don't feel like being a husband or a wife today. No, no, no. There are no timeouts in this thing. You're in a battle at school and you don't even realize it. You're a student and don't understand that the things you do now as a student will open up the doors of opportunity for your future. You better fight like you can now so that your future is not so hard later. There's a battle going on. Some of you are just in a battle for your future success. You got to join in the battle. But not only do you have to join in the battle, you got to stay in the battle. You got to stay in the battle. So let's look at verse 11. Actually, we'll look at maybe 11 to 13. And so it was when Moses held up his hand that Israel prevailed, and when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. Continuing on. But Moses' hands became heavy. So they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. And Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side, the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. So Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. So the battle is going on. Joshua has put together his army, and Moses has gone up to the top of the hill so he can survey the scene. So he's up there, he has the rod of God, the same rod, mind you, that he held up with his hands all night long. And a strong east wind began to blow, and then by morning, the Red Sea had been parted. For those of you who've been watching movies and he just walks out and he stabs, no, no, he doesn't do that. The Bible says he stood with his arms up all night long with that rod, and the sea was parted by morning. Okay? So this same rod, he says, I'm going on the hill with the rod, and we're going to do some things up there. Okay? So Moses goes up with Aaron and Hur, and he's holding his arms up, and his arms become heavy. And he begins to let his arms down, like, you know, after about an hour or so, I don't know. He lets his arms down, and then all of a sudden, the children of Israel are losing the battle.
Yeah.
So then he puts them back up, and then they start winning again.
But then his arms got so heavy that they had to put him down, and then Aaron and Hur came and got a rock, and they put it on him, he sits on the rock, and then they hold his arms up for him. So that they can continue to win. Now I know we've heard passages, people preach about this passage before, and they've talked about how it's a great example, and believe me, it is. It's a great example about support. It's a great example about supporting your leader. And I believe in that with all my heart, because I have one of the best supports I think I could ever ask the Lord for in Reverend Jackson. He holds me up. He holds my hands up. He does some things for me that in his prayer life and in his support of this ministry that really blessed me. And some of you do the same in other ways. Y'all are always holding me up. If y'all think I look like I'm winning, it's because there's some other people holding me up. But where is Joshua? I know we're up on the hilltop now, and everybody's got the hands up, and we, you know, we're trying to win, you know, we're doing our thing, but where is Joshua? Joshua is knee-deep in Amalekites. Joshua is down in the valley. Moses has his hands up, Joshua is fighting. Joshua may not even realize he's winning. Moses puts his hands down, Joshua is fighting, and he may not even realize he's losing. But he's in there. He doesn't leave when he starts losing. He doesn't run away when it looks like things are getting dark. He sticks it out. The whole time, no matter what's going on up on the hill, Joshua is down there swinging his sword, shooting his bow, doing whatever he's got, throwing rocks, I don't know. Joshua's just out there fighting for his life and fighting for his destiny and fighting for his freedom and fighting for his future. Joshua is putting in 100% effort and does not really know or even care about what's going on up on the hill. To reach the place where God is going to take you, you've got to stay in the fight. You've got to stay in the fight. You've got to stay in the fight, because if you don't stay in the fight, you'll never win. You'll never win. 2 weeks ago, May 25th, my wife and I celebrated 19 years of marriage. Amen. 19 years of ups, 19 years of downs, 19 years of win, 19 years of lose, 19 years of sickness, 19 years of health, 19 years of richer, 19 years of poorer. For those of you trying to take poorer out of your wedding vows, you need to get over yourself. It's going to happen, baby. 19 years of richer, 19 years of poorer, 19 years of sunshine, 19 years of rain. 19 years where we stayed in the fight, and even when one of us tried to walk out of the fight.
That's right.
Yes, sir. You didn't hear me. Some of y'all think it's perfect. No, no, no. The God that's in the middle of it is perfect. But it's not perfect. Even when one of us or both of us wanted to leave the fight, we had enough God in us to remind us to stay in it. Quitters never win. Winners never quit. You got to decide what you're going to be. Whether you're going to be victorious with God or the alternative. Let them be civilian, but try. Moses is going to do his part, y'all. Listen, I don't care what stage you are in life right now, or what it is you're trying to achieve, whether it's a promotion on your job or trying to get a new level to your education. Moses is going to do his part, okay? You can't get upset with the faculty because the faculty didn't do it like you wanted to. They're doing their job. They're going to do their part. Whether you like it or not, whether you like the procedures or not, they're going to do their part. And your supervisor, can I get mad with your supervisor? Because your supervisor going to do his part with all the power and authority that they have. And yes, they will mess up your schedule, I know. And you want it to be off, but it's okay. They're going to do their part. The question is, what are you going to do with your part? your time staring up at the hilltop, or you're going to get down in there and stay in the valley. Because you can't bail out. You can't bail out on your job. Some of us have bailed out so many times, you had more jobs. Oh my goodness, Lord have mercy. I'm talking about your resume is so long, it's 3 pages, and all that is just 2 years. You didn't even stay at your job long enough to prove yourself. You didn't stay in the battle long enough to get a promotion, and you already said, but this place ain't for me. No, 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 no. You got to realize, baby, I'm going to tell you a secret. You better get this right. Work is a curse. Read the book. Go over to Genesis. It wasn't until Adam and Eve sinned that God created work. He said, because they sinned, they will have to eat by the sweat of their work is a curse. So don't think that somehow the curse you at right now at ABC Acme Company is going to be less than what it is over there at CDE Acme Company. All of that is a curse, baby. The question is, can you stay in the battle for the doors that God is going to open for you? And I'm going to leave you alone. Last thing I want to tell you is that you've got to remember the battle. You've got to remember the battle. Let's go to verse 14. This really caught my attention. Scripture says in verse 14, then the Lord said to Moses, write this for a memorial in the book and recount it in the hearing of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. He goes on to say, and Moses built an altar and called his name, the Lord is my banner. For he said, because the Lord has sworn, the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. God said to Moses, write this down in the book. Now, the book he's talking about, Moses is the writer of the Torah, the first 5 books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. It's in here, and we're reading it in the book of Exodus because God told him to write it. Write it for a memorial. Write it so you'll remember. But wait a minute, hold on. He's very specific. The Lord says, you write it in the book so that you can read it over and over again, not for yourself, but to Joshua. You just stood up on the hilltop. You have all this mighty power. You have the rod of God. The hands have gone up. The people have won. Write it for a memorial, but let's not remember what you did. Let's remind Joshua about what he did down in the valley. Some of us are going to have to learn from our experience. We have to learn from our victory. We're going to remember where God has brought us from. We're going to have somebody encourage us every once in a while to tell us, you know what, I remember when. That's going to help you take on the next battle in your life. Because, you know, Joshua doesn't just lead this one battle. Joshua goes out and they fight against Og, and they fight against Sihon, and they fight against Jericho, and they fight against so many people through a 40-year span, and they keep fighting. And I believe that Joshua had this confidence because Moses wrote it in the book, and he reminded him, remember that first day. Remember when you had nothing. Remember when you were just a slave who had been free for about a week, and we just came across Amalek, and you and God went out and did something miraculous. No, you were not on the hilltop, and no, you weren't the leader that everybody was looking to, but somehow you pulled it out.
Yes,
we need to remind ourselves of the victories. And not only that, while you're at it, why don't you tell them what's going on the hilltop? Let me tell you something. This is personal. I'm very hard on myself. I am my biggest critic. You all, that's why most of the stuff you all, if y'all ever said anything, I have heard what you have said about me. It does not bother me. Remember, I told y'all a few years ago, be the duck. Let the water just roll off the back. Okay? It's because I'm my biggest critic. And sometimes I criticize myself so much that I can't pick myself up. And you know what happens during those times when I can't pick myself up? Either my wife or my kids will come to me and say, "But Daddy, you remember what you did? Do you remember when at church you said this? Do you remember when we struggled and we came through this? Do you remember the things that you've already done in Tuskegee? You worried about the church, you praying for the church, but look at what you have already accomplished, and look at the plans you have for the future." They always remind me of how far I've come. Probably about that third one, I'm starting to feel my strength come back. I'm starting to feel myself get excited again. Because sometimes working and struggling and toiling for your destiny will bring you down, but you've got to be able to make it through the hard times. You need to remember your battles. You need to remember what you learned in your struggle. You need to remember and set up a memorial when you made that A in class that you thought you could not make, or that B in class that you thought you could not make. You've got to remind yourself that you're able and that you're capable. During the times you thought you couldn't meet the deadline on your job, but you met it anyway. In the times that you thought your family was going to fall apart, but you stayed together anyway. You need to remember every victory that God has put in your path, because one day you're going to have to stand on the hilltop.
Amen.
One day you're going to have to be that next leader. But you must always remember, no matter how dark the day and how deep the valley and how traumatic it may have been for you and how much you had to struggle and sweat, if you're walking with the Lord, the battle is the Lord's.
Yes.
The battle belongs to Him.
Yes.
It is not our fight. It is our privilege to participate in it. But ultimately, the battle is the Lord's. There is no weapon that is formed against you that shall prosper. Because God is going to teach you how to win. And God is going to teach you how to have confidence in your next battle if you can just remember what He did in the last battle. If you can just grab on to what God is already doing in your life, you will realize that it is He who is the battle axe in the time of battle and a shelter in the time of storm. If you're going to realize that you have been called more than conquerors, and that you are the head and not the tail, the first and not the last, that you and God are a majority. Because what God has for you is right in front of you if you will walk forward. You may be scared. And you may have your apprehension. But courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is the willpower to still step forward, though you may be afraid. And though you may not know what the outcome will be. But if there's one thing that you can trust in, it has to be that God is with you. That He has ordered your steps. That He has already peeked into your future. And the person that you will be one day, the one that you and God pray about and that you dream about, is possible. But you gotta first prove yourself. Don't talk to me about how great you think you are. Show me. Because greatness is not a moment. Greatness is a lifetime. Greatness is not some moment that all of a sudden you look up and you're on top of the world. No. Greatness is the climb you made to get there. Greatness is the habits that it takes to get there. Greatness is the way of living that causes you to get there. If you want to be great, you've got to do the same things that great people do, not just stand where great people stand. So when the call comes for you, and the Lord asks you to gather your arm, go into battle. When God asks you to do something you've never done before, when God asks you to go a place you've never gone before, trust that it's a part of your journey. Trust that it's a part of your destiny. Don't make any excuses. gather your army, prove yourself.
Yes.
Join the battle. Stay in the battle. And when you come out on the other side, and your clothes don't even smell like smoke,
yeah. Well,
remember that.